Today's experiment is determination of percentage of copper in a given brass sample. Brass is an alloy of copper and zinc, and it is used for various purposes, making locks, hinges, bearings, automobile gear, decorative items, ammunition casings, and so on. And its properties can be varied by varying the composition. The usual composition of brass is copper around 60 to 80% and zinc 20 to 40%. In this experiment, we make use of oxidizing nature of cupric ions. They can oxidize the iodide ion from potassium iodide and liberate iodine. The liberated iodine can be estimated by using a reducing agent, that is sodium thiosulfate, with a starch indicator. The experiment, it is divided into two parts. First part is preparation of brass solution. Determination of percentage of copper in brass sample can be carried out by iodometry, colorimetry, or spectrophotometric method. In today's experiment, I am going to demonstrate you the iodometric method for estimation of percentage of copper in the given brass sample. So now we are having the two parts for the experiment. First part is the preparation of brass solution, and the second part is determination of percentage of copper. So first part we take, that is the preparation of brass solution. Brass foils are weighed and they are transferred into a beaker. So we take brass, which is consisting of copper and zinc. Basically, it consists of copper and zinc, and with some amount of impurities that can be in the form of iron, tin, lead, etc., varying from 0.5 to 1.5%. In this case, the weighed brass foil, it is reacted with 1:1 nitric acid. We add in this 1:1 HNO3. Once we add that 1:1 HNO3, both copper and zinc, they will go into solution, forming their respective nitrates. It will form cupric nitrate. Oxide of nitrogen are evolved, and water molecule is formed. So here, these oxides of nitrogen, they are dark brown fumes. They are toxic fumes, and because of that, this reaction must be carried out in an efficient fume hood. So once once the brass dissolves completely and the fumes subside, we can take out our solution, and then we add to this solution around approximately 1 gram of urea and heat it. This is done to expel the dissolved oxides of nitrogen, which can interfere in our experiment. So after this, after heating and cooling, we can transfer this solution into a standard volumetric flask. And once we transfer it into a standard volumetric flask, we make sure that every trace of copper ion is transferred into the standard volumetric flask. And after that, we are making it into 250 cm³ standard volumetric flask. Once we are obtaining this solution, we are going to make use in the second part of the experiment. For determination of percentage of copper, we draw 25 cm cube of the brass solution in a conical flask and then add ammonium hydroxide solution dropwise. This is done to neutralize the nitric acid, which is otherwise a strong oxidizing agent and can oxidize the iodide ion into iodine. So once we add ammonium hydroxide, it forms ammonium nitrate and water and neutralizing nitric acid. We need to stop the addition of ammonium hydroxide when we obtain a slight bluish white precipitate due to the cupric hydroxide. Once we obtain a bluish white precipitate, we need to dissolve it in glacial acetic acid to bring back the cupric ion into the solution. That cupric acetate solution, we can add potassium iodide solution, 1 test tube, 10% potassium iodide solution is added, that liberates iodine. So the reaction here is, this is cupric acetate, this reacts with Ki and it forms cuprous iodide, Cu2I2. So it is cupric acetate. Cupric acetate reacts with Ki to form cuprous iodide. Cuprous iodide and iodine is liberated and it will be forming potassium acetate. So this liberated iodine, because of this liberated iodine and cuprous iodide, which is a white pigment, the solution turns to a coffee color solution. And this solution, it is titrated against the sodium thiosulfate solution taken in the burette. Once you titrate with sodium thiosulfate solution, the iodine gets consumed. From here, the free iodine, it reacts with sodium thiosulfate, it will be forming Na2S2O3, it is the sodium thiosulfate. It reacts with iodine, it will be forming Na2S4O6 and it will be forming 2NaI. This is the brass foil we will make use for making a solution of brass. It has been cut into small pieces. I'll put this brass foil into a weighing bottle and record the weight of this brass foil along with the bottle. Brass foils were dissolved by adding 1:1 nitric acid. Once you add 1:1 nitric acid, both copper and zinc, they go into solution forming their respective nitrates and the oxides of nitrogen are evolved and the reaction has to be carried out in an efficient fume. Because they are toxic in nature, these fumes are toxic and it can adversely affect your health. And that is why after the fumes subside, we add around 1 gram of urea and heat it to remove any traces of dissolved oxides of nitrogen. After that, we cool it to room temperature and transfer it into standard volumetric flask to make a solution of brass. So, all these apparatus, it has been washed with tap water
and then with deionized water. So you need to wash all the apparatus first with tap water followed by deionized water, and then you transfer it into a volumetric flask using a funnel. And transfer the washings also to the standard volumetric flask. Otherwise, the copper ions sticking on the sides will change the concentration. So, minimum 2 to 3 times you need to wash it and transfer the washings into the flask. After this, we will make up the solution with the help of water by adding deionized water. So we need to make up up to the mark with the help of water. So we can add directly with the help of water bottle, that is near to the mark, and later we can make use of a burette or a pipette to transfer the remaining amount carefully so that it doesn't exceed the mark in a burette, and then add, or otherwise you can add it with the help of a pipette by raising it, by raising the flask to your eye level. So it is now correctly the lower meniscus touching the mark. So we will close this and mix it well to get a uniform concentration. By turning it upside down 6 to 8 times, we can obtain a uniform concentration of the solution. Now we need to rinse the pipette. We need to draw 25 cm cube of this solution and transfer it into a conical flask. So before transferring, before pipetting out, we need to rinse the pipette with the given solution. For that, you need to take little amount of solution into the pipette and rotate in such a way so that the entire surface is rinsed. So we can do the rinsing like this by rotating in such a way so that the entire inner surface is rinsed, and then discard it into the sink. Similarly, we can take the solution little above the mark. Regarding the pipette, you know this is a 25 ml pipette having a mark over here, and if we take a solution up to this mark, it will be 25 cm cube. So what we will do, we will take the solution little above the mark, and once it touches the mark, immediately we transfer it into a 250 ml conical flask. By the time it is getting transferred, we will make use of this burette, and in this we will take sodium thiosulfate solution. Before putting the sodium thiosulfate, again we will rinse it to avoid any change in concentration which may happen because of the water present on the inside wall of the burette. So this 25 cm cube of the brass solution may contain some amount of nitric acid. Unused nitric acid may be present, and that can again oxidize the iodide ion to iodine. To prevent that, we need to neutralize it. This can be neutralized by addition of ammonia, which is there in this burette. I'll add this drop wise. We need to add ammonia till it gets a, it gives a bluish white precipitate. Yeah, so now you can see that it is having a slight turbidity because of the cupric hydroxide which is formed and which is blue in color. So what we need to do, if I continue with my titration now, I cannot get the correct value because the copper has gone in precipitate form. So I need to dissolve it in glycolactic acid. Once I add glycolactic acid, it will dissolve. So observe it carefully. So again it becomes transparent. So it becomes cupric acetate. So this cupric acetate, it is present. It is still contains, the solution is still contained zinc nitrate. But that is not going to interfere in our experiment. So what we will do now, next we will add one test tube of KI solution. When I add KI solution, it liberates iodine. So the reaction which is taking place, this is Cu2 plus and 4Ki. I have added Ki over here. It is resulting into the formation of cuprous iodide and iodine is liberated and 4K plus. So this liberated iodine, we need to titrate with a sodium thiosulfate solution, which I have taken in a burette after rinsing. So this contains sodium thiosulfate solution after rinsing. Our experiment, we will continue in the experiment by titrating this coffee color solution with sodium thiosulfate solution. Make sure that your nozzle is filled, there is no air gap, and the burette, it is not beyond 0 cm cube. So this has been taken care of. So initial burette reading here is 0 cm cube, and then we will titrate this with the thiosulfate solution. As the reaction progresses, the sodium thiosulfate is going to react with iodine, forming sodium tetrathionate and sodium iodide. Because both these products are colorless, and hence the color diminishes as the reaction progresses. You need to titrate it till that iodine concentration becomes low. That means when it becomes pale yellow in color. If you add in the beginning itself, when the iodine concentration is high, it will form water-insoluble starch iodine complex, and return of iodine into the solution will not be proper. And because of that, it will give rise error in the experiment. And that is why I'll make it very pale yellow in color. So here we have got a pale yellow color. We'll add a few more drops to make it more paler. and then we will add the starch indicator. Nearly 2 ml of starch is to be added, or 10 drops, and this may be around 2 ml, so I'll add it. It will form a deep blue color complex with the traces of iodine. Please do not record the reading now. What you need to do, continue the titration till the blue color disappears. You have to be very careful. We have the end point, you should add very slowly, drop wise. Till the color becomes milky white or the disappearance of blue color. Probably this will require one more drop. So now we have obtained a milky white color and the blue color has disappeared completely. We can take out the burette. Never leave the burette like this because it may not be very straight and may not be in the level of your eyes. To avoid the Pallet's error, we need to take it like this. So now the burette reading is 19.9. So we'll record this into our tabular column. First reading, initial volume 0.0 cm cube, and the second one, final reading is 19.9. We'll fill up for the second trial, we'll fill up the burette again. Once you fill up the burette again and fix up, we can do another trial. Another trial can be carried out. We can add the other steps have been carried out in a similar fashion what I have showed you. That is addition of ammonium hydroxide solution followed by acetic acid. After that, we will again add one test tube of KI solution and titrate it against the sodium thiosulfate solution. In the beginning we can add fast because the iodine concentration is high, and once it becomes low we can add it slowly so that we cannot skip over to the end point. Again, we will make it pale yellow. Again, we will do the same thing, add 2 cm cube of starch indicator and titrate in a similar fashion. Relax slowly, dropwise. I think you can observe that the addition is dropwise till the blue color is discharged. So we'll get a milky white color, and we are getting, again we need to take out the burette reading. It is coming exactly as 19.9 only. So one more trial has to be completed. and in a similar fashion, and you will obtain the concordant volume will be 19.9 cm³. We can make use of that and do the calculation and find out the percentage of copper.
Now let's look at observations and calculations. Part 1 of the experiment was preparation of the brass solution. For that we have weighed the brass sample, which was taken in a weighing bottle. So weight of the brass foil and the bottle was W1 gram, that is 5.9557 gram, whereas the weight of the empty bottle, that is W2, was 5.6771 gram. Thus, we can say the weight of brass foil can be obtained by subtracting W2 from W1, and it will be 5.9557 minus 5.6771, and it will be equal to 0.2786 grams. The part 2 of the experiment was estimation of copper, in which we have taken in the burette the standard sodium thiosulfate solution, whose normality was 0.0175 normal. Rest of the details we have discussed in the demonstration part, like we have taken 25 cm³ of the brass solution and added ammonium hydroxide solution followed by acetic acid and 10% KI solution. Coming to the first trial in the experiment, we had initial burette reading as 0.0 cm³, and the final burette reading was 19.9 cm³. Thus, the volume of thiosulfate rundown in cm³ was 19.9 cm³. Similarly, in the second trial, we had the initial reading of 0.0 cm³ and final burette reading as 19.9 cm³. So the volume again run down was 19.9 cm³. Suppose we get the third reading also 19.9 cm³, then our concordant burette reading will be 19.9 cm³. Now we need to calculate the normality of brass solution. For that we can make use of formula, that is NV of brass solution is equal to NV of thiosulfate. So the N of brass solution, that is the normality of brass solution, is equal to NV of thiosulfate divided by V of brass solution. We know all these values. As N of thiosulfate, normality of thiosulfate is 0.0175 normal, volume concordant burette reading, that is 19.9 cm³, and V of brass solution taken is 25 cm³. It works out to be 0.01393 normal. Now we need to find out the weight of copper present in 250 cm³ of brass solution. This is obtainable by multiplying the normality of brass solution by its equivalent weight, and we divide it by 4 to obtain the amount in 250 cm³, because otherwise we will get, if I take that N of brass solution multiplied by the equivalent weight of copper, I will obtain this value as gram per liter. But I need to find out this in 250 cm³, because we have prepared the solution in 250 cm³. So I divide it by 4. So finally it will become 0.01393 into 63.54 divided by 4, and it will be equal to 0.2213 gram. So this is the amount of copper which is present in our solution. We can find out the percentage of copper in the given brass sample by taking the formula A by W into 100, where A is the amount of copper present, A is the amount of copper present in its 250 ml solution, and W is the weight of copper which we weight of brass foil which we have taken in the beginning. So it will become 0.2213 into 100 divided by 0.2786, and it will be equal to 79.4%. So finally we can say the percentage of copper in the given brass sample is found to be 79.4. Thank you.